Well, traveling, thankfully traveling gives her a lot to write about. In 2013, Stacy went to New York City with her then 14-year-old son, Quinn, to watch her older son, Derek, play a sax in Carnegie Hall with jazz musician David Sanborn. Because Derek was traveling with his band, this trip morphed into an organic adventure for Stacy and Quinn that puts the movie Paper Moon to shame. Today, Stacy presents the fourth speech in the storytelling manual, the touching story with her speech entitled Mother-Son Bonding, One Neurotic Moment at a Time. Her speaking objectives today are to understand the techniques available to arouse emotion, to become skilled at arousing emotions while telling a story. Her speech time today is 6 to 8 minutes, green at 6, yellow at 7, red at 8. Please welcome Stacy Molsky.
As soon as we landed at JFK on Saturday night, I immediately took my youngest son, Quinn, to Chinatown in the pouring rain. Being that Quinn is enamored with all things martial arts, he had it in his mind that he wanted to buy some nunchucks. So I said, yeah, sure, nunchucks, yeah, no problem. Because I thought, one, we're never going to find them. And two, even if we do, they're never going to sell them to us. Well, within 15 minutes, he was in one of these spice shops that was reminiscent of what you would buy Steven Spielberg's Gremlin in. And he had found them. Well, I thought, of course, that I would have to be the one to pay for it. I there would be some interaction with me, so I made my way to the back of the shop, where I found Quinn conducting the transaction was an old Asian man who barely spoke English. And I said, do you need my approval for this? And he said, in broken English, no, boy, have cash, all good. Then he turns to Quinn and he goes, be wise with nunchucks. I said, that's all you got? You just sold my kid a martial art weapon and you have be wise? I found out later that actually constitutes a legal liability release in Chinatown. Which I would believe because I saw no sign of law enforcement south of Canal Street. So after that, we went to dinner because, you know, wondering what you're going to do and how you're going to get this through TSA really works up an appetite. We ate at a hole-in-the-wall Chinese restaurant where no one spoke any English. In fact, to order, we just pointed to dishes that other people were eating. And I have to say, it was all delicious. And at the end, I put my credit card on the table. And again, from across the room, broken English, I hear, no card casually! And I thought, well, I have no cash. Quinn, I'm going to have to leave you as collateral while I go in search of an ATM. He looked at me like I had just sold him into slavery. I kind of had. And I said, and if they want you to wash dishes, make sure you wear gloves, because I bet that water is really nasty. So off I went to find my ATM. I found a Chase Bank. I did wander around for a little bit. I found a Chase Bank, and it's still pouring rain, by the way. But it was locked away in an atrium, so I had to wait until somebody came and slid their card. And when I got in there, all the ATMs were in Chinese. Everything, the screen, the buttons, everything. I thought, well, I can muddle through. I tried. It took me a while. I think I actually did some offshore trading and bought some arms in Mongolia, but I got it to finally spit out $200 for me. So I ran back to the restaurant, and to my horror, Quinn was gone. I couldn't find him. After a quick search, I did locate him in the back in the kitchen with yet another old Asian man in a white apron and no teeth, teaching him how to use nunchucks. Yeah, couldn't believe it. So I gave him some money with the ticket that had all this Chinese writing on it, which I was assume was the bill, and I'm not sure, but I think I actually bought back my son. So, anyway, we left the restaurant, And it was late, we were going to take the subway, so we go down into the subway, and like true New Yorkers, we had bought our Metro card. And so mine went through, but his did not work. So I said, you know what, I heard the train coming, let's just jump the turnstile. Isn't that illegal? And I'm like, well, kind of, but, you know, only if you're caught. So he did jump he reluctantly did what he was told. And sure enough, out of nowhere, this big burly guy comes and he goes, hey, what are you doing? Get back here. And I'm pretty sure he was not a cop. Pretty sure. So, like any responsible adult with a 14-year-old, I said, run, come on, the train is coming, let's go. And he's going, well, wait, but what about, and I just pretend like you don't hear him, just run. So he runs, we catch the train, the door's closed, but then I notice the goon is in the car behind us and he's looking at us. And that's when it got a little freaky. So we got off at the next stop, we run up to the street, and it so happens that we end up in front of the Greenwich Village Comedy Club, which is where I used to work. And so I didn't know if the guy was chasing us, so I said, Quinn, come on, let's go in and catch the late show. He goes, what? Wait, don't you think? Wait, no, come on, let's go in. He goes, can I even get in? And I said, not if we don't try. So I went up there, and for some reason, the bouncer let my 14-year-old son in, even though the minimum age was 17 to get in, probably because I implied it by saying, this kid is 17, let him in. So they did. We were in there, and to my surprise, we sat in the show. It's very late now. But to my surprise, Quinn did get all the raunchy jokes, which I thought, well, I'm going to have a little talk with this kid later. I don't understand why he's laughing at that. After the show, I chatted with comics, and Quinn sat off to the side and observed these moments in which he got to witness his mom in a completely different way. The comics and I drank, we told more raunchy stories, and the more big we got, the quieter he got. He just observed. Well, and then after that, eventually, a hooker came in off the street and ordered dinner. I don't know. It was one of those crazy, crazy nights. At 4 a.m., I decided we should probably go back to the hotel. And I could tell my son was quietly impressed when I was able to hail a cab like an expert with a ear-piercing whistle and a wave of my hand, and this car just stops right in front of us. On the ride uptown, he turned to me and he thoughtfully said, Mom, this has been crazy. You left me as collateral in a Chinese restaurant. You forced me to run from the law. You lied about my age to get me into a club. You made me step over passed out drunks in the subway. You even let me buy nunchucks, and we haven't even been here for 24 hours. I have just one thing to say to you. And I thought, here it comes, yet another big open can of teenage whoop-ass. And he quietly leaned into me and he said, thank you. On the right, and then I suddenly remembered my own unconventional adventures with my dad, who was an investigative reporter with the Oakland Tribune. He frequently took me on stakeouts and these assignments that were really not good. My parents divorced before I was born. I never knew them together. I never had that family, the yard, the dog, all those things I read about in the Dick and Jane primer. But they did the best that they could when they shuttled me back and forth. As imperfect as that sounds, its imperfection served me well, and I wouldn't change a thing. After that trip, I stopped beating myself up over the mistakes I've made with my own kids, because now I realize they aren't necessarily mistakes. Because at the end of the day, I've come to realize that combining unconventional parenting with conventional parenting love makes for some pretty cool human beings.